1971, when military analyst Daniel Ellsberg leaked the Pentagon papers to the press, they were a top-secret Defense Department study of U.S. military involvement in the Vietnam War. Their controversial publication blew the lid off what one famous journalist called a bright, shining lie. But few know that in the decade before that, during some of the Cold War's most dangerous hair-trigger moments, Daniel Ellsberg also spent years analyzing America's nuclear weapons policy. His new memoir chronicles that period. It's called The Doomsday Machine, Confessions of a Nuclear War Planner. And in it, Ellsberg argues very little has changed about what he calls our immoral and insane policies regarding nuclear weapons. Daniel Ellsberg, welcome to the News Hour. The title of your book comes from the famous Stanley Kubrick movie, where a rogue U.S. military officer launches an attack on the Soviets, and as those weapons are flying, it's suddenly revealed that the Soviets have built a doomsday machine, this enormous global booby trap that if they're attacked will kill every single thing on Earth.
It is not a thing a sane man would do. The doomsday machine is designed to trigger itself automatically.
But surely you can disarm it somehow?
No, it is designed to explode if any attempt is ever made to untrigger it automatically.
Ah, it's an obvious comic trick, Mr. President. We're wasting valuable time.
At the time, it was somewhat considered a fantasy idea, but you argue in this book, and this is the title of your book, that's really what we have on our hands, is a doomsday machine.
Yes, when you hit it, Jim, Kubrick got that idea from Herman Kahn, a colleague of mine, a friend of mine at the Rand Corporation, who put it forth as a hypothetical device for deterrence, but he said that would kill too many people.
Surely no one would build a device.
Killing everyone. He said no one would, no one had done it, and no one, he felt, would ever do it. But he was mistaken. There was a doomsday machine at that time. We didn't know, actually, till another 20 years, about the phenomenon of nuclear winter, that the military targets we were going to get in cities, and actually in those days, they planned to hit every city over 25,000 in the Soviet Union, and in China. If we were in war with the Soviet Union, we would also hit China. Those cities burning would have wafted in firestorms, not ordinary fires, but as in Hiroshima or Tokyo or Dresden, that would waft the smoke and soot by tens of millions of tons into the stratosphere, or it wouldn't right now. It would be for over a decade, and it would lower the sun's temperatures on the Earth, the sunshine, by about 70%. Meaning
agricultural holocaust.
All the harvest would be killed for years, basically. And everyone, nearly everyone, would starve.
In 1961, as a young consultant to the Secretary of Defense, Ellsberg remembers being shocked after seeing a top-secret document estimating how millions of people would be killed with a U.S. nuclear strike on the Soviets.
And when I held that piece of paper in my hand, the look in my mind was evil. Evil. This should not exist. This is the operational plan annually for the Joint Chiefs of Staff that had been approved by General Eisenhower. And I thought, there shouldn't be anything in the world that corresponds to this, but there has been then and ever since.
Your book documents many of the mishaps and mistakes and near misses that many Americans may not be aware of in the last 40 years of our nuclear era. But yet somehow we have escaped annihilating ourselves. Why is that?
Look, will it work for another 70 years? I'm not confident of that. At this very moment, for example, we are making nuclear threats against a nuclear weapons state, a state with nuclear weapons.
You're referring to President Trump saying we will rain fire and fury on the Koreans.
Right. Now, fire and fury could include napalm, white phosphorus, a lot of high explosives, which they've experienced before in the 1950s. They've been through that, and it's not something they want again. But that could quickly escalate. They didn't have nuclear weapons yet. There has been no imminent threat of any attack, really, or a nuclear attack on a nuclear weapon state since the Cuban Missile Crisis. That was half a century ago. I was part of that, and I have concluded after 40 years of research that neither Kennedy nor Khrushchev intended at all to carry out their threats of armed conflict. I believe they both believed in their own minds they were bluffing and that they would pass off if necessary. And yet, on the decisions of one man is crazy.
In addition to his book, Ellsberg is back in the public eye again because of this.
Do you have the papers?
Not yet.
Steven Spielberg's new movie details the Washington Post decision to publish parts of the Pentagon Papers, the ones Ellsberg leaked, in which the Nixon administration tried to stop. The legal fight went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court. The movie is called The Post, and it's in theaters this month. I'm just curious why you think the story of the Pentagon Papers is still resonant today.
We've had a war going on against the media, and it didn't start with Donald Trump. Barack Obama prosecuted three times as many people for leaking as all previous presidents put together. I was the first to face such a prosecution. That's why my name is coming up now, I think. Well, there were two after me before Obama, and then nine, or ten, depending how you count some of them, under Obama. I believe that Donald Trump has shown every sign that he will continue that, though he hasn't yet. He's actually berated his attorney general for not coming up with indictments for leaks right now. I have no doubt that Attorney General Sessions will meet his demand.
The book is called The Doomsday Machine, Confessions of a Nuclear War Planner. Daniel Ellsberg, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Church and Queen. I have a good news and bad news transit story for you tonight. Let's get the bad news out of the way, and it probably won't come as much of a surprise to you at all. Bombardier is not going to make its promised target delivery of our new streetcars yet again. By now, Bombardier should have delivered 120 of the new cars to Toronto. Instead, we only have 57. There have been multiple revisions and delays with Bombardier, promising 70 by the end of this year, but that was downgraded to 65, and then just 2 weeks ago, to 64. That leaves seven still to be delivered by the 31st, and a TTC spokesperson told City News today they won't all realistically be here by then. No delays are putting quite a strain on the TTC. The streetcars like the ones that you should be seeing running up and down here on Queen are old and way past their lifespan and literally on life support, and it's getting harder and harder for the TTC to keep them up and running, especially in the cold. Okay, so now the good news. Well, again, it deals with Bombardier, and for the first time in a while, Bombardier and Metrolinx are on good terms again after a long simmering dispute. Their dispute has been settled, which is great news for the Eglinton crosstown, actually potentially opening
up in 2021. This is very, very good for that way.
That is Phil Burster, the new president and CEO of Metrolinx, who comes with a reputation for being tough, which may be why, just weeks after he took over, the long legal battle with Bombardier has come to an end, saving taxpayers millions. The $770 million deal has been reduced to $392 million, and the number of cars slashed by more than half, from 182 to 76. Metrolinx just didn't need as many after former Mayor Rob Ford came up with this slogan.
Subways, folks. Subways, subways.
And City Council killed the Scarborough LRT. The heated battle between Metrolinx and Bombardier centered around the pilot car for the Eglinton crosstown, which was supposed to be ready 2 years ago. Metrolinx was so concerned it was going to put the entire project in jeopardy, it threatened to kill the contract, which led to Bombardier taking legal action to stop them. But even though the two sides have now reached a transit detente, they still can't agree on whether the test car is actually up and running. Metrolinx has been saying it hasn't been operational. Bombardier has been saying, yes, it's working. Is it working or not?
So the pilot vehicle is a very important part of the delivery program. I am confident that Bombardier has all of the opportunity to deliver that pilot vehicle to us on the timeline we've agreed and for it to be fully operational to the level we specified.
But you're not answering the question. Is it operating? Is it running? They say it's running on its own. What do you think?
It will run according to the program.
I'm going to say that's a no. You don't think it is. decide for yourself on that one. Now, the deal is being described as a win-win for both parties. In exchange for cutting the number of LRTs, Bombardier is getting an extended contract for the maintenance and operation of the GO lines, which is quite lucrative for the company. And it will also face much stricter penalties if it does not meet the LRT.
Fresh and new.
Excellent. We like fresh and new. Saw the film yesterday. I brought a couple of friends. It was a really fun time.
Oh, good.
Really fun time. And I'll be honest, I was skeptical because Magical Summer.
Right.
Grew up with it. Robin Williams, all that, you know.
Yeah, me too.
Did you like it when you were a kid?
Okay, no, I lied. I didn't see it when I was a kid. I saw it when I signed on to this one, and I really liked it.
Okay.
But I was 4 and 7 when I saw it.
So yeah, I was skeptical going in, but man, it's fun. And genuinely, I was chuckling.
Nice.
Really, really funny. I think he got most of my laughs.
Oh, nice!
I'm gonna give you that.
Right, don't tell Dwayne the Rock.
I probably won't get this album. You're playing a character who goes into a game world, but you are a woman inhabiting it. So, a teenage girl.
Yeah.
And you play it very, very well.
Thank you. It was a lot of fun. And you know, it was a character that I'd had brewing for many years that I'd never had the opportunity to play. Because no one had ever said, hey, you want to play a teenage girl? You know, it's not,
that's
not a role.
Come along.
I was thrilled because I was like, I know exactly what I'm going to do with this character.
I mean, that's her. That's it immediately. Seriously.
Thanks.
It's really, really fun.
You know, that's the key. If you can find a thing that you're having fun with, then that's cool. If that's the name of the game, it's hard to find.